The ayes to the right, 202. The noes to the left, 432.
The ayes to the right, 202. The noes, the ayes to the right, 202. The noes to the left, 432. So the noes have it. The noes have it. Unlock! On a point of, indeed, point of order, the Prime Minister.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, the House has spoken and the government will listen. It is clear that the House does not support this deal, but tonight's vote tells us nothing about what it does support. Nothing about how. Nothing about how or even if it intends to honour the decision the British people took in a referendum Parliament decided to hold. And people, particularly EU citizens who've made their home here, and UK citizens living in the EU, deserve clarity on these questions as soon as possible.
Order! There's no good people shouting. There will be an opportunity for other points of order, but the Prime Minister must and will be heard. The Prime Minister.
Those whose jobs rely on our trade with the EU need that clarity. So, with your permission, Mr. Speaker, I'd like to set out briefly how the government intends to proceed. First, we need to confirm whether this government still enjoys the confidence of the House. I believe that it does, but given the scale and importance of tonight's vote, it's right that others have the chance to test that question if they wish to do so. I can therefore confirm that if the official opposition table a confidence motion this evening in the form required by the Fixed Term Parliaments Act, the government will make time to debate that motion tomorrow. And if, as happened before Christmas, the official opposition declined to do so, we will, on this occasion, consider making time tomorrow to debate any motion in the form required from the other opposition parties, should they put one forward. Second, if the House confirms its confidence in this government, I will then hold meetings with my colleagues, our confidence and supply partner, the DUP, and senior parliamentarians from across the House to identify what would be required to secure the backing of the House. The government will approach these meetings in a constructive spirit, but given... Given the urgent need to make progress, we must focus on ideas that are genuinely negotiable and have sufficient support in this House. Third, if these meetings yield such ideas, the government will then explore them with the European Union. Mr. Speaker, I want to end by offering two reassurances. The first is to those who fear that the government's strategy is to run down the clock to the 29th of March. That is not our strategy. I've always believed that the best way forward is to leave in an orderly way with a good deal and have devoted much of the last 2 years negotiating such a deal. As you confirmed, Mr. Speaker, the amendment to the business motion tabled last week by my right honourable and learned friend, the member for Beaconsfield, is not legally binding, but the government respects the will of the House. We will therefore make a statement about the way forward and table an amendable motion by Monday. The second reassurance is to the British people who voted to leave the European Union in the referendum 2.5 years ago. I became Prime Minister immediately after that referendum. I believe it's my duty to deliver on their instruction, and I intend to do so. Every day that passes without this issue being resolved means more uncertainty, more bitterness, and more rancour. The government has heard what the House has said tonight. But I ask members on all sides of the House to listen to the British people who want this issue settled. And to work with the government to do just that.
I will come to other colleagues, but first of all, point of order, the Leader of the Opposition, Jeremy Corbyn.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. The results of tonight's vote is the greatest defeat for a government since the 1920s in this House. This is a catastrophic defeat for this government. After 2 years of failed negotiations, the House of Commons has delivered its verdict on her Brexit deal, and that verdict is absolutely decisive. I hear the words of the Prime Minister, but actions of her government of the past 2 years speak equally clearly. She is only attempting to reach out now to try to keep her failed process and deal alive after it's been so roundly rejected by Parliament on behalf of the people of this country. Labour has laid out our priorities consistently. No deal... No deal must be taken... No deal must be taken off the table. A permanent customs union must be secured and people's rights and protections must be guaranteed so they do not fall behind. At every turn, the Prime Minister has closed the door on dialogue. Businesses begged her to negotiate a comprehensive customs union. Trade union leaders pressed her for the same thing. They were ignored. In the last 2 years, she's only had one priority, the Conservative Party. Her governing principle of delay and denial has reached the end of the line. She cannot seriously believe that after 2 years of failure, she is capable of negotiating a good deal for the people of this country. The most important issue facing us is that the government has lost the confidence of this House and this country. I therefore, Mr. Speaker, inform you I have now tabled a motion of no confidence in this government. And I'm pleased that motion will be debated tomorrow, so this House can give its verdict on the sheer incompetence of this government and pass that motion of no confidence in the government.
First of all, just come to the leader. I will come to the right honourable gentleman, of course, but a point of order, the leader of the House.
With permission, Mr. Speaker, I should like to make a short business statement regarding the business for tomorrow and the remainder of this week.
I'm extraordinarily grateful to the Right Honourable Lady, and I accept that she can't be psychic as to what I'm thinking and I can't be psychic as to what she's thinking. I think the smooth and orderly way to proceed with this matter is to deal with points of order first and then to come to the Right Honourable Lady's statement, which would be entirely proper and doubtless helpful to the House. Point of order, Mr. Ian Blackford.
Speaker, we should be aware of the situation that we're in. The clock is ticking. We have got very little time to resolve this. The fact that it has taken us so long to get to this point, frankly, is shameful. Yeah. This is a humiliating defeat for the government. Yeah. When I listen to the Prime Minister, it sounds like everybody else is at fault rather than her.
Responsibility
for what has happened this evening. Mr. Speaker, I'm delighted that the Leader of the Opposition has come round to a motion of no confidence. This should have happened before, but of course we will support it. Mr. Speaker, as I mentioned, it is clear the clock is ticking. The government needs to secure the safety of all our nations and should immediately postpone the Article 50 process. Should immediately have talks with all the leaders of the opposition parties. Let's work together in all our interests, but let's listen to the voices of the parliamentarians that have been sent here. There is no support for this deal. It mustn't come back again. The obvious thing to do, the right thing to do, suspend Article 50, put this to the people in a people's vote.
I know the Right Honourable Gentleman won't take offence when I say he was using the device of a point of order, as is entirely understandable in these circumstances, to say what he wanted to say, but he was more interested in what he had to say to the House than in anything that I might have to say to him. It's not a matter for the Chair. The Right Honourable Gentleman has registered his view, and these are the sorts of issues that can quite properly be aired in debate and quite conceivably in discussions that take place with the Prime Minister and other party leaders. But he's made his point with force and alacrity, and it's on the record for colleagues to study. I will take the Honourable Lady first, Right Honourable Lady first, and then others. Point of order, Jo Swinson.
Mr. Speaker, with this result of a scale that is unprecedented in recent times, it is clear that this deal, nor any tweaks to it, will get through the House of Commons. So can I ask for your guidance, Mr. Speaker, on how Parliament can assert its authority to make sure that we can give the people of this country a say on this deal to resolve this matter? It is a mess that needs to be resolved by the people in a people's vote.
Well, my response to the Honourable Lady is as follows. First of all, there may well be an opportunity for her to air her own thoughts on that matter, the situation we face and the suggested way forward, in the course of debate to which the Prime Minister, in her point of order,
referred, there is that prospect potentially unfolding. So that's one opportunity for the Honourable Lady. And the second would be those discussions to take place in coming days. And I dare say that the Honourable Lady will want to take the chance to participate in those. More widely, where there is discussion about Parliament's role and what Parliament might do and what options Parliament might have, I think I can predict with complete confidence that the Honourable Lady will have a view about that. And that view, which is important, will be heard. And point of order, Mr. Angus Brendan McNeill.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. The Prime Minister spoke about the will of Parliament, Mr. Speaker, and I think we have to investigate that further. When can we test the will of this House on the choices that are now left? The choices are no deal versus revoking Article 50. Can we test these in the House? And bearing in mind, of course, that in Scotland, the European Union is more popular in the polls than the United Kingdom, and the Prime Minister should know that.
There'll be plenty of opportunity for testing in the days ahead. I think the... Well, can I just take the... Honourable Lady first. Point of order, Dr. Philippa Whitford.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. This isn't a political point of order. Yesterday, it was raised the issue of the member for Hampstead and Kilburn and the fact that she should have been undergoing a caesarean section today for a high-risk pregnancy, and she is comfortable with me saying she has gestational diabetes and was asked by her medical team to undergo that at an early possibility.
So we're back after this monumental defeat, more than double the highest estimates that people predicted this vote would go down to defeat. It is monumental, and there's been a huge amount of conversation about a no-confidence vote. And we're back with obviously Hala Gorani, Carol Walker, and our chief business anchor, Richard Quest, about just digesting even higher than the worst estimates for her.
That is a phenomenal and a shattering defeat. It is worse than the worst estimates of how badly Theresa May was going to lose tonight. And I think that it may well change the whole dynamic of what happens next. This is the worst defeat of a government this century. It is setting a new precedent. Extraordinarily, the Prime Minister appeared to be composed, appeared to be sticking to her prepared
script. She looked very much like she was expecting something bad to happen. Maybe not this bad, but...
But what we have now seen is the Leader of the Opposition, Jeremy Corbyn, saying that he's going to call a vote of no confidence in her government. The Prime Minister confirming that that will take place tomorrow. And interesting that during her brief statement, she talked about how she wanted to try and now have cross-party talks to work out the way forward. Well, Jeremy Corbyn was pretty dismissive of that idea and mocked the whole suggestion that you could have a deal defeated on that scale by MPs on all sides of this argument and somehow think that you can salvage something from it. So I think that we will see this confidence motion tomorrow. The Prime Minister may well survive that. The government may well survive that. But whether the Prime Minister can now continue, I think there are now new doubts about that.
But what happens, though,
if the
government doesn't survive?
Well, she'll continue in the sense that she has... I mean, what was interesting is also, as soon as she saw the size of that defeat, she was the one who said, I recognise there is now time for a confidence motion and will accept the motion if the Leader of the Opposition puts it. She almost short-circuited
his thunder. It was coming.
And then... So now it really becomes, do all her members, all her MPs who voted against her on this motion, vote with her on a vote of confidence? Because if she wins the vote of confidence tomorrow, as is expected, then we are back to square one with no deal that anybody can accept. If she loses tomorrow, then we're off to a general election.
Yeah.
And there is that question now as to whether maybe some of those real hardline Brexiteers in her party will now think that actually things have got so bad that they're better to have a general election. I should say, of course, that there is another option. Yes, the Prime Minister has survived a confidence vote from within her own party. That can't happen again. But there is more than one way of getting rid of a Prime Minister. And if the Cabinet now decide that she is simply not the person to carry this through, if her cabinet, her ministers turn against her, then the Prime Minister could still be forced from office or could still decide herself that given the scale of this defeat, that it's time for her to go.